Well, good morning. On this Sunday before we celebrate the birth of our Savior Jesus, it's a good day to come and gather for worship. It's a great service this morning and this evening and Friday night and next Sunday, and plenty of opportunities for us as a church family to gather together and to sing songs and to worship the Lord and to focus on this unique time of the year where we celebrate the Savior's birth. Let me just share a couple of announcements with you briefly, if I could. In the pews there in front of you, you may see a yellow communication card. I'll refer to that a couple of times this morning, and we want to welcome everyone here this morning. But if you're here for the first time, or you've been here just two or three times, if you have not filled out one of these, just to let us know that you're here, and just a little information, we'd appreciate that. Just fill it out. Leave it in the pew there, and we'll pick it up after the service. Certainly, if anyone has a question, has a prayer request that you'd like to forward to the pastors and the staff, please put that on the communication card and leave it there in the pew, and we will gather it up, and we do pray for those. But we just want to welcome you. And for first-time visitors, again, a special welcome to you. And when the service is over, if you step out to our information booth, we'd like to give you a gift and certainly answer any questions you have and share with you a little bit about our church, if that's of help. Welcome. It's a wonderful day to gather and worship the Lord. Just real quickly, this morning, all the children and youth who are participating in the children's Christmas program this evening, they'll be dismissed when we dismiss for greeting time. They'll be dismissed to go downstairs for one last gathering before this evening. And then we mentioned a couple weeks ago that Jill and Jesse Ortiz are in need of a couple of newer vehicles. Theirs are well-worn and in need, and we just wanted to remind you, if you'd like to donate specifically to that, please write a check or take some funds, put it in an envelope, designate it specifically for them, and we will gather those funds and forward them on, and we appreciate. Ortiz Car Fund would be clear to communicate to us. And this evening, please plan on attending our children's Christmas program. It's going to be a great time of sharing of the kids performing for us. They've been practicing hard for several weeks, all going back into October, and it will just be a good time. Also plan next Friday night, our annual Christmas Eve service. These are always special services, special time to gather together as family, and also as church family. That will begin at 6:30. And in your bulletins, you'll see these little invitations, which can be for you, but they're also for you to perhaps use as an invitation to a neighbor or a family member or someone else to invite someone else to come and gather with us for the Christmas Eve service. And there are more of those invitations out on the info booth if you'd like more of those. Anna Peterson is a hardworking, gracious lady in our church, and she has a special invitation. If right now it appears you may be alone on Christmas, she is more than happy to invite you to share that day with others at her home. At her home, 4603 Falcrest Street here in Caldwell. She'd like to invite you to join for a Christmas potluck dinner. There's more information in your bulletin, and Anna's here this morning. You can ask her any questions. She has a great heart and just would rather people gather together with some others to celebrate Christmas. So that's at 4 p.m. on Christmas Day. Next Sunday, our service begins at 10:30. The following Sunday, the 2nd of January, it begins at 10:30. A little later start times, no Sunday school. The idea is to come, gather for a service, perhaps be with your family, and then afterwards, invite someone else to go out to lunch with them. It's just a great time to have some fellowship with some others here in the church family. Some you may know, some you may not know as well. It's a good time to just say, hey, let's go grab some lunch and get to know each other a little bit better. So there's two opportunities for you. Children's ministry. Let me just give you a quick update. Last January, we made a transition, and at that time, we had one Sunday school class. We had three or four key workers, teachers, and since January till recently, we have expanded. We now have two Sunday school classes downstairs. Both are fully staffed with teachers and helpers on a rotating basis. We don't want any one person to teach or to be a helper every week. We want to have a job share type environment where people can come and be working with the children, build relationships, have consistency, but also be involved in a Sunday school class, or particularly during children's church, that people would be able to be here in the service the majority of time. And yet, we've also added children's church time. That began a few weeks ago. It's been combined for the last few weeks as part of the preparation for the children's Christmas program that's going to be held this evening. But in January, on the 9th, that will start up again as children's church. The ages will be 4-year-old through first grade. And we want a rotation of teachers and helpers. If you would like to be a part of that, we would love to have you grab that communication card and just write Children's Church, and I'll get in touch with you and see if there's a place there. We'd like for people to be downstairs with the Children's Church no more than once every 6 weeks or even perhaps every 2 months. It is not a major commitment, but if we have a pool of people, teachers and helpers, then we can provide the consistency the children need. And at the same time, we want people to be here in our church services the majority of time. It takes a number of people to staff our Sunday school classes and our children's church in this way, but I think it is honoring to our teachers and helpers and respectful to our children to have good programming for them with good teachers and leaders, but also those teachers and leaders are in a rotation that's honoring to them. So that's just a little bit of an update, but please, and maybe you've signed something before, if you're interested and you have not been involved, please just note that, and I will personally get in touch with you and just see if we can find a good fit. All right? Offering box is out in the foyer. There's two of them on the wall. Please, take a good look in your bulletin this morning. Again, that's where your Christmas Eve invitation is found, and all of the information you need is inside that bulletin. So, if you would you pray with me? Father, this morning, it is a great day to gather to worship you. It is cold and crisp outside, but inside it is warm with your presence. It is a great day to be gathered together, shoulder to shoulder, with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Today, Father, we want to worship you through our song and through our prayer, through our open, humbled hearts before you. We want to worship you. Jesus, we want to thank you that we can celebrate your birth as the Creator who entered into creation for the purpose of giving us new life. We thank you. And Holy Spirit, we desire for you to be powerful within us. Open our eyes to understand the truth of your scripture. Move us to align our priorities with your priorities, our purpose with your purpose. Help us to see and understand the selfish ways that creep into our life and distract us, that we can push those aside, fixing our eyes upon Jesus. And Spirit, we thank you that we have you dwelling within us, that we are not alone in that purpose. Today, Lord, we do desire to give back a portion of what you have blessed us with in the form of an offerings to you, to be used to further your kingdom through this church, to meet the needs within this church body, to support our missionaries throughout the world who are proclaiming your gospel. Lord, we thank you that you are at work in our midst. Every day, every time we gather, we can tell story upon story of your mighty work in our midst. We are real people, Father, with real needs. We are not airbrushed and perfect. We have all the warts and all the other things that make us very real. And our needs are very real. And in that, Father, we come to you. We recognize that we can lean on our finances, on our friends, on our hospitals and doctors, but ultimately, Father, we recognize that it is you that we come to, that we depend on, that we look to for salvation, we look to for assistance, we look to you as the great physician for healing. We look to you to guide and direct us in difficult times and in difficult decisions. You are the one that we can rejoice with. We can come to you like literally our Father and call upon you for the help and assistance and just the companionship and fellowship that brings you joy and brings us great fulfillment. So today, Lord, as we gather together, looking forward to next week when we specifically celebrate the birth of Jesus, thank you that we can be here, gather together to worship in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you would, stand with me, and we will repeat our verse of the month. With me, John 1:14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John 1:14. And now take a few moments for greeting. Children and youth, head downstairs.
Good morning. We ask you to return to your seats. I hate to interrupt all this wonderful fellowship. It's wonderful to be with you this morning as we continue our celebration of Christ's birth. And we would ask that you would join us in worship this morning as we sing hymn number 82, O Come, Let Us Adore Him.
We'll be right back.
Unto us a child is born. Our message of hope this season. And may we share that message everywhere we go. Let's be that light this Christmas season. Would you stand and join us as we continue to worship? Hymn 136.
Oh,
Number 132, Angels We Have Heard on High. Please be seated.
The Advent wreath is a circle with no beginning and no end, which makes it a good symbol for endless love and faithfulness. Out of darkness, light shines, pointing us in hope to the one who came to overcome the darkness of this world and to be our light in the world to come. John chapter 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of men, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." The fourth candle of the Advent wreath is called the Angel's Candle. It reminds us of the hope fulfilled in the first coming of our Savior and of our continuing hope as we anticipate his coming again.
Gloria, Gloria, Good morning, church. Now you're awake. I knew you were already, though, because you've been experiencing worshiping the Lord through song, and now we're going to continue to worship the Lord through His Word. Would you bow with me in a word of prayer? Father God, I have to admit to you this morning in front of all of my brothers and sisters that I am a sinner, saved by grace alone, and this is a humbling task. It is really an impossible task for me, as you know, because my words are not able to describe your glory. But Lord, I will try, and I pray that by your Spirit that you would communicate yourself to us today. And we depend not on man, but we depend on your Word and the Spirit, that the Word would be preached and the Spirit would give us understanding this morning. Lord, I pray that in all of the hubbub of Christmas time, that we would come to a laser beam focus this morning on Jesus Christ, and we would exalt you, that we would worship you with all of our hearts. Lord, that we would recognize that what we're talking about this morning is the point of life, the reason we live, the reason you created us, the reason Jesus came to this earth, and the reason we are saved and can enjoy fellowship with you as we stand in your beautiful light for all eternity. And so, Lord God, I pray this humble prayer would be heard. I know it is being heard because, Lord, you say that we can pray to you and you will hear our prayers because we have an advocate, Jesus Christ, who allows us to enter into the throne of God in prayer and supplications. Lord, I pray for all of the prayers of the congregation, Lord, to be heard by you and that you would continue to move powerfully in us and that we could look at all the wonderful things in our lives and say, it is because of Christ alone that I am blessed. It's because of Christ alone that I have security. It is because of Christ alone that I am forgiven. It is because of Christ alone that I possess the love of Jesus, both for you, Lord, to give back to you, and to give to others. And I pray, Lord, that that would be manifest in our lives this week. And all God's people said. A few years ago, I was at Warm Lake Camp and was leading a game called Capture the Flag. And, of course, you have to play this game at night because the essence of the game is that you are to remain hidden so that you can capture the flag and sneak up on it. I ended up being myself the holder of the flag, and that year the flag was a lightsaber. And so I planted myself on a stump on the side of the mountain in darkness, and they blew the whistle, and the kids started up the mountain to come, and as long as they came up and grabbed that light, then they would win. The game is rigged because there's multiple counselors sitting around with flashlights, and whenever they see a kid move or hear a kid move, they shine the light, and when the light is shined on, you have to go back. I'm told that no one has ever captured the flag in the history of Warm Lake Camp. This particular year, we were catching kids left and right, and I thought no one was going to capture the flag, and so I was waving my light, and the kids were attracted to it, and they kept coming to try to find it. And then all of a sudden, from up above the mountain, which is very rare in this game, I heard running. A kid had gotten up behind me. He had snuck up in the darkness very skillfully and come up behind me and decided that before he was caught, he was going to make a running shot at it. In the dark, through the rocks and the trees, having no idea what was coming. As a matter of fact, he was so good at what he was doing that he was running so fast that he ran right past me. And I knew that ahead of me was rocks and all kinds of branches, and I'm thinking, this is not going to be good. And so as he ran past me, I reached out my hand and grabbed him by the shirt, and it probably looked like some kind of a Bugs Bunny cartoon. Boing! And he stretched back, and I planted him right next to me, and I looked at him, and I said, young man, don't ever do that again. Sent him back down the mountain. You know, two things struck me about that experience. One is that the darkness is very dangerous. You can't see in the dark. All kinds of bad things can happen. And I'm sure we all have many stories of bad things that have happened in the dark. But I will tell you the other thing that struck me was that this young man was trying so hard to get to the light. And that's the message of Christmas, is that the darkness is so very dangerous. And we'll look at the scriptures which tell us how very dangerous the darkness is. But there is a light in the darkness, and that light shines for us to find him. Unlike Capture the Flag, Jesus can be found. He can be captured. He can be held onto. He can be followed. And so we want to look at the concept of light. We've been looking at the connections of Jesus throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament. We looked at him as the Lamb and how this theme runs throughout Scripture. We looked at him as the Word, and that theme also runs throughout Scripture. But it is perhaps this theme this morning that runs through most of the books of the Bible. And that is the theme that God is light, and that light came to earth in Jesus Christ. And so I want to ask you to turn to what I'm going to call our anchor verse, our verse that we want to hold on to this morning, and that is where Jesus tells us exactly who he is. And it's from the book of John, chapter 8, verse 12. John, chapter 8, verse 12. Now, what's fascinating about this statement in verse 12, Jesus is at the Feast of Tabernacles, and he makes this statement in verse 12, and the Pharisees completely run into another direction. They don't even answer the question. They don't even respond to the issue of what Jesus brings up, because they want to talk about, well, you're claiming to have all this authority. You need to have multiple witnesses. And they run off this track. But we oftentimes miss the very point if we just look at this verse alone of what Jesus is claiming to be. And he's claiming to be three things. Let's take a look at it. Again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. That's a verse to memorize. Jesus claims three things here. First, he says, I am the light of the world. And by saying he's the light of the world, he is describing his character and he is describing his purpose. He came to be a light, but he's also, his character is light. Who he is morally, who he is in thought and deed, who he is as a whole is light. Secondly, he claims that if we follow him, we will not walk in darkness, that we will escape the darkness if we follow Jesus. And thirdly, the way we escape it is we will have the light of life. Isn't that a wonderful statement? That when you follow Christ, you have the light of life. And we're going to unpack that concept, because that concept should be understood from the Old Testament and on. So Jesus claims these three things, and we're going to really unpack these things. We're going to come back to this anchor verse as we explore the Old Testament and the New about how Jesus fulfills all three of these things. As a matter of fact, we're actually going to look at five different ways that Jesus is light today. The first is he's the light as the source of life in creation. The second is he is light as the source of guidance in the pillar of light in Exodus. Thirdly, he is the light as the source of rescue in the prophecy of Isaiah 9. Fourthly, he is the light as the source of salvation in the incarnation in John chapter 1. And fifthly, he is light as the source of glory in the new heaven and the new earth in Revelation. So first, let's look at the concept of light in the creation. Will you turn with me now? We're going to be skipping through a lot of verses, so keep your fingers ready. Genesis chapter 1. And as you know, that we've gone to Genesis chapter 1 in every one of these sermons. And so the concept of light exists here as well. And creation displays, in just the first few verses, this concept of light. But one thing it does is it contrasts light with darkness. You see, light and darkness are always competing in the Bible. They're always in contrast to one another. You can have only one or the other. You cannot have both light and darkness. One brings life and one brings death. One shows what is around us, the other conceals what is around us. Light and dark are contrasted, strictly speaking, in the Bible. And this passage in Genesis is where the contrast begins. Read with me, if you would, verses 1 through 4. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. This is the first picture of the separation that must occur between light and darkness. And God sees fit in the first bit of creation, the first time he speaks the word creates what? Light. Isn't that wonderful? We talked about Jesus is the word, so therefore Jesus creates light, and he separates the light from the darkness. And what does he call the light? Good. You see, we see here that the unformed state of creation, creation without the good things that God puts into it, is darkness. It says that, doesn't it? It says, without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. It's to leave us with this concept that it's just void. It's without meaning. It is without hope. It is without goodness. It's just this canvas of creation. And God says nothing is inherently good about it. Nothing is said to be good about this picture. Nothing is said to be bad about it at this point. Darkness will take on an evil characteristic once sin enters the world, but at this very basic level, there's nothing said to be positively good about the darkness. But the good and well-intentioned state of creation, when creation starts becoming good, is when God introduces light. And this light, when God first creates it, is not from the sun. He doesn't create the sun on this day. He creates a light. And so we understand this light to be the light of God, that this is the glory of God shining on creation. And it is the first thing that he called good. Light is good, and so we could say darkness has not been called good, at the very least. And it is only after he creates light that God creates all the living things on earth. Did you notice that? It is after he creates light that he creates the plants, the trees, the creatures that swim in the water, the creatures that fly in the sky, and all that lives on the land was all created after he created light. And one of the things that we are to learn, and scientists know this, that God created living things to continue to live because of light. God made plants to need light to live by a process called photosynthesis. And so plants live, they can only survive by light. Well, that's good for plants, but what about living things? Well, everything we humans eat is plant-based or animal-based, and all animals either eat other animals or they eat plants. And so we eat those things. All of these things are created by light, or light helps them to survive, except for Oreo cookies. I don't know what that's made out of. But everything else we eat, besides a few things, is plant-based and animal-based. And so light is the way we must survive. One scientific article said of photosynthesis, during this process, some of the sugars plants produce get stored in fruits and vegetables. So basically, we eat converted and stored light. Interesting? And that's from a totally scientific source, understanding the power of light, that it produces life. What kind of life does darkness produce? Does darkness contribute in any way to life? It doesn't. There are no qualities of darkness that produce light, life. And so it's important to understand that the concept at the very beginning of creation is that light produces life. And so we need to develop this a little bit more, but we're going to get to that when we get to Jesus. Let's keep going about what characteristics light has in the scriptures. Let's turn to Exodus 13. Light does not only produce life, but it also is the source of guidance. We're jumping ahead to the story of the Hebrews as they have escaped slavery in Egypt and the important role that light played in their life and existence. You see, God guided them through the wilderness because they were following His direction completely. They just headed out into the wilderness, and these hundreds of thousands of people were directed in their travels, and they were directed by God Himself. And there was a supernatural thing that would happen where God would make a pillar of cloud, this giant cloud that didn't look like any other cloud, and the cloud would move, and they would follow that cloud during the day. But then at night, He would show up in the form of a pillar of fire. And at night, they would actually move, and He would guide them by this pillar of fire to where He wanted them to go, to direct them to the place that they were to be. Now, I don't know if you've ever thought about that before, but imagine being out in the desert and a giant pillar, what, maybe 100 feet tall or taller, this giant pillar of fire is in your midst and is guiding you along. And the picture seen here is that when you're lost in the darkness as a people, you don't know where you're going, that this light, keep following it because it will guide you. Notice what the scripture says of it in chapter 13, verse 21. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud and led them along the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, that they may travel by day and by night. The pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night did not depart from before the people. As long as they stayed with the light, as long as they followed the light, they were guided in a good direction. But it helps us to understand that if they did not have the light, if God did not provide this light, this pillar of fire at night, then they would be completely lost if they tried to go it alone, right? If they said, you know, God, we don't need the pillar tonight. Let's turn it off and let's head out. They would be in all kinds of trouble. And we know this because we've been in the darkness without light, and we know how dangerous it is. And this is a picture of the danger of darkness. That if you don't have light, then you will be lost in darkness. And light serves as a function of a guide. We all know this because we have cars that have headlights, right? But it's true of the darkness of evil as well. Evil will never lead you in the right direction. It will never guide you to God. It will only make you lost and unable to find Him. Listen to what the scriptures say. Proverbs 4:19 says this: "The way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble." Boy, that's a picture of darkness, isn't it? You stumble over things and things prevent you from getting where you need to go, and you don't even know what it is. And it says that that's the way of the wicked. The wicked, they fall over things and they enter into a life of sin, and they don't even know what's happening to them because they're so lost in darkness. And likewise, Jesus says in John 12:35, He said, "The light is among you for a little while longer," in reference to Himself and that He was going to die and be resurrected. "Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you." The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. And so this is Jesus' warning to say, if you don't come to my light, then you're going to wander around not knowing where you're going in life, not knowing your purpose, and being lost and without hope. I once went with a group to visit a bunker called Fort Stevens in the northern Oregon coast. Fort Stevens is a fascinating place to go. I highly recommend going. It was a fortress during World War I and World War II, but even earlier. And it had these massive guns, and they were called hidden guns because there was a huge pile of dirt in front of it, a wall of dirt, actually, and it guarded the mouth of the Columbia River. And if enemy ships were to come in, these guns were hidden, nobody could see them, and they would pop up on these big mechanical devices, and then they would fire at the enemy and then hide back down, and the enemy would have no idea where the firing was coming from. It was a fascinating idea. But by the time I got there, those guns were long gone. And they had these giant pits where the guns used to be, and then they covered over those pits. And so there were these bunkers that you would go into to go see where the guns had previously been. A lot like going into a cave, which is, you know, my favorite thing. So we went into this bunker to go find this big pit. And so we go into this bunker, and all the lights are on, and you see this huge pit to see how big these guns really were. And then the tour guide says, "You want to know how dark darkness really can get?" And I was like, "No." He said, "Well, besides you, anybody?" And everybody said yes. And so he turned off the lights. And I don't know if you've ever experienced true pitch black, but man, it was dark. And I found myself standing over this pit going, isn't that a picture of life without light? Is if you try to get around in that situation, you could fall into the pit and die. You could be lost in there forever. Because we need light as a guide. We need light to be able to see where we're going. And then isn't it amazing how lost we can feel in the darkness, completely lost, but then all you have is a light. You just turn on a light, and all of a sudden you know exactly where to go. Light is a wonderful guide. So brothers and sisters, we should see God's light as a sure guide in a place where there is no other sure way to go. He is the only true light. We should also see that God does not leave us without a guiding light. He's a trustworthy light. Notice what it says in verse 22. The pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night did not depart from before the people. In other words, the pillar of fire never went out. It was never extinguished. It was never a night where they said, oh, did God forget about us? He forgot to turn on the light. That never happened is what it's saying here. It says that God always shines as a light. It's a light that doesn't get snuffed out. It's always there. And isn't that an amazing thing? That in our greatest and darkest days, God is always shining the light for us to follow, to say, follow me. I know the way. That leads us to our third picture of light in Isaiah. Will you turn with me to Isaiah chapter 9? Isaiah chapter 9. Now, we're all familiar with the prediction of Isaiah chapter 9, which says, for unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. But did you know that the prophecy is a promise to rescue people from the darkness and bring them to the light? And that the fulfillment of that is in Jesus Christ. Now, in this text, I want to remind you about a verse before chapter 9 in chapter 8, verse 22. As it describes the people of Israel, as they've rejected God and they don't seek him, he talks about a darkness that they've entered into. It says in verse 22, and they will look to the earth, but behold, distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish, and they will be thrust into thick darkness. This darkness covered the land. The people had walked away from the light of God and had decided not to seek him. But instead of finding enlightenment, the result is that the people were in distress and anguish. They were scared. They were without hope. They had lost their purpose for living. And verse 22 is a good picture of what darkness is like and the contrast between light. When we seek to live in darkness, we are truly lost. Not only do we need a guide, but we are also lost in the sense of lost in our own sin. We lose meaning without light in the darkness. We lose truth. We lose purpose. We lose help. We lose protection. You know, Christmas time is an interesting time of the year for numerous reasons, but did you know that it's a time of great depression and anxiety for a lot of people? And one reason for that is that it is actually the darkest time of the year. Did you know that this Tuesday is going to be the darkest night of the year, this Tuesday, the winter solstice? And that is connected to anxiety. That's connected to depression and a gloominess because darkness is connected to that. Remember, darkness doesn't give life. Darkness pushes down life. And so we see here that darkness is pictured as bringing about a sort of distress of the soul, a darkness of the soul. And so we should realize that anybody who doesn't have Christ is in this darkness, and that's why this promise in chapter 9 is so vitally wonderful. Take a look at what the promise is in chapter 9, verse 1. But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the later times, he made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. It's saying there's not going to actually be any more anguish for those living in darkness because something special is happening in this land called Galilee. The people, verse 2, who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them the light has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you with joy at the harvest as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for fire. What does the light do according to this passage? When the light from Galilee comes, it will provide three things. It will provide joy, as verse 3 says. You'll have your joy increased. Verse 4 tells us it brings freedom from slavery. It says that the oppressor, the staff, the rod of the oppressor, and those who hold us under burden will be broken. And then thirdly, he will bring peace. That means that all of the clothes used for war will be burned because they're not necessary anymore because all warring will cease. You will have joy, freedom from slavery, and peace. And why do you have this? Take a look at the next verse. 6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it, with justice and with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Amen? So this prophecy promised a light that would dispel the darkness in the form of a child born to rule the earth and to rescue people from distress, from slavery, and from constant warring. Who could that child be? Turn with me, if you would, to John 1. We move to point 4, the incarnation, that not only is light the source of life, it's not only the source of guidance, it's not only the source of all of these things, it is also ultimately the source of salvation. In John chapter 1, we see Jesus as the light who fulfills all of the Old Testament pictures of the need for light. He gives life, he gives guidance, and he gives rescue. Notice that all the things we've just discussed are all discussed in John chapter 1. And Jesus is the fulfillment of all of these things. First, we looked at creation and that light gives life. Let's look at how Jesus gives life in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In verse 4, we see the explanation of our anchor verse, John 8:12, which says that whoever follows Jesus will have the light of life. So what does John 8:12 mean when it says that we will have the light of life? Well, we know and have learned that light gives life. But John 1:4 explains how Jesus gives life. It tells us this. The reason why we have life in the light is, verse 4, in him was life. In Jesus was life. So Jesus is the source of life. So if you want to have life, you have to get it from its source. And Jesus is the source of life. He is the light in that sense. And we are the plants, like photosynthesis. When we are connected with Jesus as the light, then we are created. We are given life. We continue to survive. But sin brought darkness, and darkness brought death, both spiritually and physically. And so we need to escape the darkness, and we need to go to the light. The darkness wants to keep that light from us. The darkness wants to keep us from finding that light and getting life. It wants us to keep in death. And those who followed Jesus, they knew that they needed to find the light out of the darkness. I want to share with you a passage that happened at Jesus's, before Jesus was born. The father of John the Baptist, he knew about the light. He knew that the light gives life, that they needed life. And so he prophesies this in Luke 1, 78 and 79. He says this, "Because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit from on high to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death." You see, those who are living in darkness are in the shadow of death, and so they need life. And he says that when Jesus comes, he will save you from death, the darkness of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. He combines the idea of saving us from the shadow of death and being a guide, which was like the pillar of fire in Exodus. Just as a wilting and dying flower falls and fails in the darkness, but rises to live when the sun rises and light is shining on it, so we live when Jesus' light touches our life. Not only that, but Jesus gives guidance. Take a look at verses 9 through 11 in John. "The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him." This is a powerful statement at the very first phrase in verse 9. The true light. The true light. Jesus is the real McCoy. Jesus is the real light. And we need to understand a couple things about lights. You see, first is there are many dark ways we stumble along that never lead to light. There are all kinds of promises in the darkness that if you go this way in the darkness, that you will eventually get to the light. But those are lies. The darkness conceals the true light and keeps you in darkness. These are the ways of the world. The ways of the world says, follow me in the darkness and we'll get to the light. They promise light but only lead to more darkness. They promise freedom but they only lead to slavery. They promise happiness but they only lead to anguish. Darkness does not guide. Darkness cannot guide you into what is good and what is right and what is life. Brothers and sisters, we must turn from the world and realize that the world is only darkness and will only lead you into more darkness. There are also many wrong lights. There are little lights, little false lights that promise you what only the true light can give you. These are the wrong ways of religion. The Jews had followed the wrong light so long that they rejected the true light when he finally came, because they were used to their little lights. When Jesus came as a brilliant, bright light in the darkness, he was too much for them, and they rejected him. False religion promises to lead you to light, but actually, once you get there, you find yourself only in darkness. I remember talking to someone who does not believe Jesus is God, and asked them, I said, do you believe Jesus is God? They said, I believe Jesus is a God. And so I asked the next question, which was, so therefore, do you know that if you were to die today, that you would go to heaven? And they said, well, since Jesus is not God, and I don't believe that he can fully get me there, I try to be a good person, and I hope I get there. Brothers and sisters, that answer has no light in it. That answer will only lead you to darkness. Verse 9 says, the true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. And that true light is opposed to all false lights. He is the one true light. There is no other light. All other lights are false and fake. And the good news is that his light shines to all people who want to follow it. Anybody who wants to follow this light, the way is open. And he will never lead you into darkness, but only to life and righteousness and blessing by what he's done. But we must follow the light, mustn't we? If Jesus shines the light and says it's for all men, we must follow it. Notice what our anchor verse says. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness. If you want to get follow the true light, then you must follow Christ. You must actually pursue him and go where the light leads. Now, it was interesting when Jesus said that, he was attending the Feast of Tabernacles. And one part of the feast was that they would light four huge candelabras in the temple. And these were huge. This is an actual mosaic of what these candelabras looked like. They were 75 feet tall, four of them. And they had these giant pools of oil and these giant wicks that were actually made out of the priest's old clothing. And so they would actually light these giant beacons of light throughout the Feast of Tabernacles. And they said that it would actually illuminate the whole city of Jerusalem, that you could see the light of the temple from these four candelabras during the Feast of Tabernacles for the entire time from anywhere in the city. And you know why they did this? They did this to remind the people of the pillar of fire in the wilderness and to continually point forward to the Messiah. And so when they had lit these giant candelabras, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. You see these things? They're pointing to me. And I'm the true light. They point to me." But you know, at the end of the feast, the candelabras were extinguished and put out. And so Jesus tells us, "I will never be put out. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The light will constantly shine." And so, brothers and sisters, we must be like a moth to a flame. We must go to the light and stay in the light all of our lives. You know, many people are drawn back into darkness. They go to the light, but then they feel more comfortable in the darkness because the light exposes our sin. When we come to Jesus, we confess our sin and we bow down in repentance before him. And not everybody's comfortable with that. But brothers and sisters, let me just encourage you, there is no other way. We must face the light or live in the darkness. Keep pursuing the light of Jesus. There's a story about a little girl in London, not particularly known for its light, who won a prize at a flower show. Her entry was grown in an old attic in a cracked teapot that had been placed in the attic window of a rundown tenement house. When someone asked how she managed to raise such a lovely flower in such an unlikely environment, she said she moved it around so it would always be in the light. And that's what we have to do, brothers and sisters. Keep moving to the light, and you will have life. But I need to tell you why you have life in Jesus, because Jesus gives us rescue from our sin. Isaiah 9 promised rescue from the gloom and anguish of the darkness that covered the land. It promised joy, freedom from slavery, and peace. And all of this is given to us through Jesus' work on the cross. Listen to what 1 John 1:7 says about the light. "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses from all sin." You see, the light of Jesus is the forgiveness of sins by his shed blood on the cross. And he calls you then to follow his light to then receive rescue from sin. His work on the cross rescues us and puts us safely in his kingdom as the children of the king. When we are rescued out of darkness, it's because of the cross of Jesus Christ, and you follow him by faith, and then he leads you into this new place, this new kingdom. Take a look at back in John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. "But to all who did receive him, who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." It is through the light of Jesus Christ that you leave the kingdom of darkness and sin, and you enter into the kingdom of light through Jesus Christ, not because of anything you have done, but because of what he has done. You see, you don't produce the light. You are given the light, and you walk in it. So listen to this. We now live in the kingdom of light. We have fellowship with the Father of lights, and we have fellowship with the people of light. Amen? But wait, there's more. Please turn with me to the end of your Bible, Revelation. Revelation 21. Lastly, the light is the source of glory in the new heaven and new earth. The glory of God, by the way, is the sum of all of his attributes. All the attributes of God are summed up in his glory. When you see the glory of God, you are seeing the attributes of God in full display. And the glory of God is oftentimes described to us as light. Actually, Luke 2:9 says about the light that shined on the shepherds, the glory of the Lord shone around them. The glory of the Lord shone around them because the glory was light. And so Jesus showed little glimpses on earth of his light glory, but it is truly in the new heavens and new earth that we see it in full form. Take a look at chapter 21, verse 22. Now remember, this is the new heavens and the new earth, and we are going to be living in the new Jerusalem on this earth, and it describes what it's going to be like in that new Jerusalem. It says this, "And I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb." The Lamb. "And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it." Brothers and sisters, we will be full of light in the new heavens and new earth in the new Jerusalem, but the light will not be from the sun. It will not be a reflection of the moon. It will not be from any other source, but where? It tells us it's the glory of God that gives light. And specifically where it comes from, its lamp is who? The Lamb. Do you see how light and the Lamb combine at this very passage? The Lamb who purchased salvation for us becomes the light in which we walk for all eternity. And he will bring a brilliant, wonderful, glorious light that we will live in for all times. Jesus is the agent of that light. And when we have faith in him, we will live in that light forever. So as I close, brothers and sisters, I want to help you see the connections. The Word of God is how we see the light, because the Word is the manifestation of God. The Lamb is why we see him, because he is a sacrifice who purchased the way for us to see God. And the light is what we see, because he chooses to share his glory with us. And it all comes down to one name, Jesus, born on a day that we celebrate this week for you and for me to share in his light. Would you bow with me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we praise you and we worship you and we honor you and we glorify you, Lord God, because we want the light. And Lord, thank you that we have received the light of salvation. Thank you that we have received the light that takes us out of the anguish and the gloom. And Lord, what a good reminder, because we can get that way this time of year. I pray, Lord God, that we have the light of life beaming out of us, that people can see the life that has been infused into us, that, Lord, there's something different about us, that we are bounding with joy and happiness because we have been given the light of Christ. And I pray, Lord God, that we would long for the day of glory when we will see your light in all of its splendor and all of its goodness. And I pray that as we sing here today, Lord God, that we would long for that very day with every fiber of our being. And I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Not a silent night. There was blood on the ground. You could hear a woman cry in the alleyway that night on the streets of David's town. And the stable was not clean. And the cobblestones were cold. And little Mary, full of grace, with the tears upon her face, had no mother's hand to hold. It was a labor of pain. It was a cold sky above. noble Joseph by her side. Calloused hands and weary eyes. There were no midwives to be found on the streets of David's town. So he held her and he prayed. Shafts of moonlight on his face. For the baby in her womb, he was the maker of the moon. He was the author of the faith that could make the mountains move. It was a lady. It was a labor of love.
Would you stand with us and sing in worship and in thankfulness for the light of the world? Here I am to worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Thank you. here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And light of the world, you step down into darkness, opened my eyes, let me see.
Oh, precious Father, thank you for the gift of your Son and for the light of the life. Father, we come to you, broken vessels. Thank you for coming to us, the perfect salvation.
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior.
Come for us, this Jesus, he's the hope for us.
Let's finish with Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Some praise this morning. Oh, Father, thank you for this day, this time of the year when family comes into town and when we gather around, Lord, and we just have a celebration of the light of life. Lord, we just pray that the joy that you've given us this morning, the hope that you've given us this morning, that we cannot contain it, Father, but that we share it with all those around us. And in your blessed name we pray. Amen. Stick around for Sunday school and come back tonight for the kids program. They've been working hard. We'll let you guys out of here with Joyful, Joyful.